Hello and welcome to my lecture on MySQL, PDO, and PHP. Now, if you've been coming all along and listening to all my lectures up to this point, starting with HTTP and HTML and SQL and PHP and PHP object orientation, and you have been sort of learning pieces, and this is the place where it's all going to come together, and I can use all those words that we've taught. Now, if you're watching this for the very first time, you might want to go back and watch those other things to kind of catch up, because the words, I'm just going to start using words that I hope to have covered in the previous stuff. But if you are with me and you have been with me all along, then congratulations on getting this far. Let's kind of do a little happy dance. You can do happy dance too. You know, you're here, you've worked hard. You can actually now start connecting all the pieces here, like a high five to the television. There we go. We got a high five. So let's bring it all together. Accessing MySQL using PDO. So here is my favorite diagram. Someone will probably make a much more beautiful diagram, but it's got to capture all these things about the browser and the web server and the database server. We are now going to do what we wanted to do, and that's send a request. It runs, it's going to run some code, and this is what we're going to do for the first time. We're going to use the PDO library to make another connection to the database server, send some SQL across that connection. SQL is going to do magic, super awesome magic stuff, which we love, and send us back what's called a record set. And we're going to write a loop that reads through the record set and then slowly but surely produces HTML. HTML will come back and then we'll have a page. And so sort of for the first time, we're going to have dynamic content showing up on the screen that ultimately came out of a database. So if finally we're going end to end. We got a lot more to do. JavaScript, we haven't started talking about JavaScript. That's all sort of here, magic in here. So, but we're not doing that. What we're doing is finally making it all the way in. And PDO is what we're going to talk about today. And the other thing that we're finally doing is we're finally sort of finishing this diagram that we started with. And that is how these web dynamic content web applications work. And that is, there's application software. In our case, we're writing it in PHP, and it does the request response cycle, and it talks to the database and sends the HTML back. And the developer builds this code. You're the developer, you're building this code, and the database administrator talks PHP MyAdmin. So we've kind of done this bit. We've been writing PHP code, but now we're going to finally do all the way in and all the way back out. And so all these things are going to finally connect together in this picture that we did days, weeks, or months ago. Okay? So, I often tell you that PHP is evolving. That's one of the things that's charming about PHP. It's evolving in a way, and lots of languages are evolving, but PHP is very good at letting you have backwards and forwards compatibility of stuff. If you want to do something a little early, you can by sort of pulling it in, or if you want to keep something that PHP took out, you just check to see if it exists and you bring it in. The way database in PHP 5 was accessed has been changed. Prior to PHP 5, there were these MySQL underscore routines. And when we talked about object-oriented, I said everything, when you don't have object-oriented, you prefix them. And so they had MySQL underscore, MySQL connect, MySQL query, MySQL underscore this. Well, when object orientation comes along, they're like, oh, let's use object-oriented patterns because we can namespace all the functions. And so the first thing they did is a library that I don't like very well. I don't like this very well, and I don't like this other one, which is really kind of a almost one-to-one correspondence between taking out the prefix and making it an object, which you could do kind of like what they did with the date underscore and the date time object. But they also took the opportunity to kind of rethink from scratch the right way to build a database. And they were informed by lots of things in this. They were informed by Java, this thing called JDBC in Java, and other database patterns. And they wanted to be portable across multiple languages. It turns out if you wanted to talk to SQL, you had a set of SQL functions. SQLite used SQLite functions. MySQL had MySQL functions. PDO, the portable part, means that it works for Oracle, it works for MySQL, it works for SQLite, works for SQL Server from Microsoft, et cetera, et cetera. And data objects means that it's both an object-oriented pattern for its API, but it also returns you the record sets in a more object-oriented way. I could go on and on and on and on about how wonderful PDO is. I'll just say PDO is wonderful. The things I did before, I kind of understood when we first looked at it. like, oh, PDO is different. I'm so used to this other stuff. But boy, once you start to use it, you're like, boy, how could we ever have survived with that old crappy MySQL underscore stuff? And so you can look on the internet the different things, but I'm not gonna pretend that there's a debate, because as far as I'm concerned, if you're not using PDO, you're foolish for a lot of reasons. We'll talk about some of those reasons as we go forward. Okay, so the thing you're gonna have to do is you're gonna have to make a database, and you may have done this already, or make a brand new one. So just create your database, MISC, and then the thing that you haven't done before is these grant commands. So these are things that you type to your MySQL, and what you're basically doing is taking all the tables, MISC.star, all the tables in that MISC database to an account. You can put anything you want in here. At localhost, this is kind of IP filtering so that you can't connect to these things outside of your computer, and that's really good to make it so your MySQL is not exporting your data to the internet. And so this is basically limiting that says this FRED account that I'm making can only be used from localhost or 127.0.0.1. These are kind of two of the same things. And then this is a password identified by grant all on MISC FRED. So this ends up being the ID and the password. Sometimes MySQL sees it as localhost. Sometimes it sees it at 127.0.0.1. You probably need one or the other of these two things. I just put both in because I don't want to bother figuring out which one I need. Okay, and then you're going to switch into that database. So we're going to make some tables. And so make your database, drop MISC and recreate it if you want. Then we're going to create a table, and we're going to just do a basic table. By now, it's been a while since we've done SQL, but I hope you sort of remember it, right? We're going to make a table called users. That's the name of the table. We're going to have some columns in there. We're going to have user underscore ID, which is the primary key. We're going to have name. We're going to have email and password, all are 128 characters long. And we're going to do an index on email. That's kind of our way of saying logical key. Email is a logical key. InnoDB, this is the thing that makes the foreign keys, the enforcement of foreign keys work, and then we're going to say charset equals UTF-8, so we can put in, you know, non-Latin characters and have it be okay. And so just go ahead and create yourself a table. If you don't remember how to create a table, go all the way back to the SQL lectures where we did that in great detail. So now let's put some users in, insert into users, name, email, and password. Here we've got Chuck and the password of 123, and Glenn and password of 456, right? And so we've created some records in our user database, and because it is we have this auto increment field, we're getting effectively a primary key for csev and gg@umich.edu. So what we've created now is sitting on our MySQL server, we've got a database named MISC with a table of users, and you know, we might have other databases, with lots of tables in them, and that's fine, because you know, MySQL just kind of isolates them. And so now what we're going to do is we are going to show you how to, in effect, log into that database from PHP. Okay, so you're in the middle of a PHP request, and now you want to log into that database. And you do this with an object-oriented pattern. So I'm naming my variable PDO. This could be $X for all I care. It really doesn't matter. Dollar whatever equals new PDO. PDO is a class. See how useful that object-oriented lecture is? PDO is a class, it's a template that's going to give us back a variable, and we give it three parameters as part of its constructor. The first is a connection, what we call a connection string, and that's defined. You can go look up the PDO documentation. In this it says we're going to connect to a MySQL database. The host is localhost. In production, usually the database is on a different piece of hardware than the application, but on your laptop, it's going to be on the same. So localhost is like, oh no, we're not going to a whole different database server, but you might, in production, put this as something quite different than localhost. And then you have to tell it what port, because this is really kind of a TCP/IP connection that we're doing here, and if you're on a Mac with MAMP, it's port 8889. And if you're on Linux, or if you're on XAMPP, or on sort of a normal, 3306 is the normal default, and MAMP's weird default is 8088. Then you have to put the database name, and that's what name of the database, because you can remember, you can have lots of databases, and we've seen that when we're playing with PHP MyAdmin. And then you have to give the password and zap. And so this ends up being just one line of code in PHP, and that makes a connection through which you can then send commands, SQL commands. Now you know SQL already, but now we're going to have PHP make the select or whatever, delete, insert, all those are going to be sent across this connection. So this variable represents, much like open file, the variable represents our way to access and send data to this send commands in the language SQL and then get results back through this PDO, through this PDO connection that we've made. But it's like logging into a system. And you're going to log in every time you get a new request response cycle. One of the first things you're going to do is log into the database, and then down there you're going to send commands and get the data back. And we'll see how that works. So here is a super, super simple first application. So this is a PHP program, right? So it starts with less than question mark PHP. I want a pre-tag, okay, just so that everything looks pretty. And the first line is make a connection to the database with these parameters. Fred and Zap are the account and the password. And then now I'm going to call the query method within the PDO, the $PDO object, which is in my variable $PDO. And I just pass in some strings, the same strings that you might type into PHP MyAdmin or the MySQL command line. You just send it. So that's sending it to the database over that connection that you've made. And then what comes back is a record set. And so we get back this record set that we can access using this dollar statement. And this is kind of like a file handle. It's a handle to a record set. You're going to loop through it. It's going to have a fixed number of rows. You're going to be told when you've reached the last one. And you're going to read it one row at a time. So every time you call statement fetch, the fetch method within the statement record set, or this is how to fetch it. Just for now, we'll leave that alone. We'll talk about that in a little bit. So you each time you call the fetch, each time you call the fetch, you get a new row. And if you run out of rows, you get false. And so we've kind of cheated here in that we put this in a while statement. So it's either going to get you the next row or it's going to be false, in which case it's going to leave the loop. Okay, so you could put this like a parenthesis not equal false, but that's kind of implied. So I had one too many equals there. I'm sorry about that. But it's kind of implied there. This both runs the loop as long as there are legit rows there, because row is not false when it has actual data. And then all we're going to do each time through the loop is we are going to print the row with printr. And then this will run however many rows that this select statement gets from the database, and we're printing it out. So give me a row, give me a row, give me a row. We're done with rows. Okay, stop the loop. That's what's going on here. And given that this is what's in the tables, this is what we see. And this is, to me, the lovely bit of this fetch associate is each row is an associative array with a key value pair where the column name is the string key. So user ID, name, email. So those are really strings. It doesn't show you the quotes, but those are really strings. User ID maps to 1, name maps to Chuck, email maps to CSEV, password maps to 123. So this first row right here comes back to you as an array. And we're going to do more with that row. For now, we're just dumping it out for debugging. Then it goes up and runs again, and then it gets, goes up and runs again, and then it gets this row. And it comes in, and then it prints that out. So we see that bit right there. The primary key is 2, the name is Glenn. And so we're just, it's as if we're reading a file or reading anything. We're getting a set of arrays, one array per row. There's also a thing, I think, called fetch all, which gives you an array of arrays. And it's not a bad way to go about it, because you're not really supposed to fetch trillions of things through a single select statement anyways. So that's kind of the simplest example. And you know, when you're doing this stuff for the first time, stick with the simple examples. Don't get too complex. Okay. But generally, we don't want to write applications that have a pre-tag and print R as their data. And so this is all the stuff at the above this. From here up, that's identical. And from, well, here down, it's not. Well, not quite. So we're gonna print out a table. So we're printing out HTML table border equals 1 new line. Prints this line out. Then we're going to do that while loop. And each time in the loop, we're going to print out a TR and a TD. Then we're going to print out the name. Then we're going to put out slash TD, start TD, which is this bit right here. Then we're going to print out the email. Then we're going to print out slash TD, start TD. Then we're going to print out the password, 123. This is a very secure system, prints the password right out. It's beautiful. It makes it a lot easier. And then we end the TD and the TR, and we throw a new line at the end, so it looks pretty. Then we go up, grab a new row and do the same thing. And then when we hit this the third time, this becomes false. So it comes out and prints slash table. And that renders like this. And so this idea of go to the database, get back a record set, loop through the record set, generate HTML, that's what we're doing here. We are reading the record set and we are using with echo statements, we're transforming it into HTML. Now, in more sophisticated environments, you have templates that do this transformation, et cetera. And so there are different ways to do this, but this is the basic idea of taking a record set and turning it into HTML, okay? It's, after a while, you just like send a select statement and then work with the data and do anything you darn well please with the data. Add it up, print it out, who knows what you're doing, right? You have all the power at that point. It's a simple concept and absolutely beautiful. So one of the things as a pattern that we do is we don't like putting this stuff at the beginning of every file, because you'll literally will eventually have 10 or 12 files and they will all want to make a database connection. And so you don't want to put the password in every database, every connection. So we refactored this code a little bit and put it from one file, put part of it into one file and part of it into another file and use include. So it also makes it so you don't, if you're using GitHub or something and checking it in, you don't want to check your database password into GitHub, because that's kind of a security hole, especially if people can read your GitHub. And so the thing we then do is we take the PDO bit and we pull that into a file like pdo.php. And all we do is we, you know, do something, maybe a side effect of the PDO. Now this set attribute, we'll explain what this is. What it really is, it's kind of like display errors. It's saying, please blow up when I make a syntax error in my SQL, because that's not the default. The default is to keep going, which if your SQL is bad, and what I mean by SQL is bad is like your SQL that select star from users isn't right. So you don't want to do that. So I just put this in. It's just a nice thing to say, look, if I make a mistake in my PDO, please totally blow up, because I'm mostly developing. You can change this perhaps in production, but in developing, that's like display errors. That's like quit now, give me some detail as to what I did wrong, tell me what's going on. But that's not what we're doing right now. What we're doing right now is we're just saying require once pdo.php, we're putting on a pre-tag, we're pulling this in, require once.pdo.php. So in third.php, there's one of these and many of these, right? So this is like whatever, your this and your events and your book and your whatever, right? Bunch of stuff. So each file that wants to have access just says require once pdo.php, and you only put the password in once, and then the rest of this stuff is exactly the same. And so you have third, fourth, fifth, 10th, 11th, and they all just require pdo.php. I probably talked a little too much about that. Okay, so up next what we're going to do is we're going to actually insert some data from PHP into the database.